I can't see any of the buttons or anything. Yeah. It seems recording. Yeah, the numbers are changing. It needs to be. But it probably could be zoomed up a little bit. Should we just put it on the.
Oh, just let it run.
Just let it run?
The
what?
Did you mean the autofocus?
Yeah.
Is it?
I can't see because the buttons are invisible without a light.
So yeah. Well, it's on auto here.
Yeah, that's okay. That's for the light. And this is for the focus. I think it's on autofocus when you turn it on. So.
Is it running now?
Yeah.
Thank you. She is taking installs to the Niagara Ponty. So she has a very Ponty chronological approach to touch. And I think that this again was the sentence that George came up with when he was starting, which was touch as a social phenomenon. And I think that a lot of Barbara's work has borne on the way touch and gesture implicate us in the social environment and serve as indices of a social environment. She's also worked a lot with and around contemporary music, although she won't own up to this in public, so I'm just throwing it in reverse. And I think that issues of, for example, touch as a point of contact between musicians, between instrumentalists, the dialogue, the different types of discourse that can be established via an instrument or via the contact that is established through different kinds of musical creations, which of course don't have to go through an instrument, they need to go through one's own modern instrument. These are issues that she's also extremely open to and keen to discuss. So I guess with that I'll throw you in. And as yesterday, we'd like to keep this format as open as possible. I think the message got through quite well yesterday, so please let's continue on these lines.
Thank you very much for the introduction. I would like to know that if I'm even more good for your expectations on the two of them, because okay, just always throw it to you as a philosopher. I invited to an interdisciplinary panel because, on one hand, philosophy is always very abstract, just to say that people who are not really involved in the interpersonal discourse sometimes are really thinking, what in heaven do they want? So I try to make here an approach, I try to present here an approach, which is characterized by the idea of giving some concrete examples, on the other hand, to show something of the philosophical discussion, which especially took place in the field of, as Jay already said, the field of phenomenal knowledge. When I started to prepare this talk, I thought about what is good introduction, and I looked at common language, ordinary language, because the notion of touch plays a very important role in our common language, and it also shows the broad or the widespread semantic space which notion which touch is characterized by. First of all, the notion of touch refers to the idea of sensation, of our senses, of the dimension of the tactile. We find in expressions like it has about the touch, or something is soft to the touch, and it also has a strong relationship to the dimension of cognition. For example, we have notions like she has to ask the meaning of sentences, what means that she has re-begriffen in Germany, it's even more clear, she has re-grasped the meaning of something. So that means that touch is a very important notion not only for the field of sensation and our sensory approach to the world, but also for the dimension of cognition. I want to speak about that in the first chapter. The second aspect, which comes apparent if you look at touch in the common language, is the dimension of verification. So touch very often has been regarded as a method of verification. We find the expressions like touch stone, or to put something to the touch, or French, even more clear, to shape the reality before. The third dimension I want to refer to is the dimension of the relationship between touch and emotions. We all know expressions like she is touched to tears, she is very touched by his work, she is tactful, she is touchy or touching us. All this shows a strong relationship between touch and emotions. And the third fourth dimension is, I would call it a magical sphere of touch. So, for example, if you are looking at religions, very often touch plays a very important role. For example, by people who are touched by a priest or a shaman, and were cured only by this notion of by this aspect of touch. So that is another aspect I want to like to refer to. And the fifth dimension is the dimension of contact. This will play the most important role in my talk. We all know expressions like to get in touch, to keep touch, to lose touch. something is within touch, so touch through the notion of contact, of proximity, of closeness. And that is especially the point I would like to refer to in more detail also by looking a bit on the philosophical discussion. I would like to finish my talk with the idea that touch could mean, nationally, it could mean a kind of different approach to the world, which I would describe as a kind of gentle approach. That touch is not mainly characterized by this idea of control and domination, something we will refer to in the talk yesterday, but more that it is characterized by the idea of the dialogue with the object which we get in touch with, the dialogue with the person which we try to get in touch with. So we have a kind of schedule for the whole thing. That is, first of all, I would like to speak something, to make some remarks about the reference of touch to the dimensions of meaning and cognition, then touch as a method of verification. Then I would like to make some remarks about touch and emotions, some remarks about touch as a magical sphere. Then I would like to go into more detail into the idea of touch as a contact with the other, or to object or the world in general. And at least I would like to start to make sure there's some ideas concerning touch as a gentle intellectual event. Okay, first aspect, touch as a source of meaning and cognition. If you look at literature from philosophy, psychoanalysis, social psychology, you find again and again that a very important first contact with the world is realized by touch. Things are touched by their parents, they touch them by themselves, their blood, the skin, the hair, and closest of them, you all know it, if you have ever had a child on your arms, and you know that they are, for example, with my long hair, that they are taking his hair, grasping what they can ever get. And the same thing is, if you look at the contact of the parents to their babies, they always caress them, touching them, kissing them, embracing them. So touch is a very important aspect concerning our view on the first relationship babies have to the world. It's not the only one, you know very well, but it's very important. As Michel Serre, the French philosopher, pointed out, this touch of oneself is, as he says, a necessary fundament of getting a feeling for oneself. So by observing babies, for example, you see very often that babies are not only touching something outside of them, but they're also touching themselves, their hands, their bodies, and something like that. And Michel Serre, by referring to Didier Antheuer in his issue, said that in this touching, in this notion of touching themselves, they get a feeling of oneself, they develop the so-called moi-co. In German it is Haut-Ich, and I try to find a translation in English, it's skin eye or something like that. And even if we are adults and we observe ourselves, then we become very well aware that we are always touching ourselves. When I try to observe myself concerning this aspect, then I realize that very often we cross our legs, we press our lips together, we touch ourselves, we could make something like this, so it's a kind of verification of oneself by touching ourselves. By this touch of ourselves, there develops a kind of dialectic relationship between ourselves and our impression of ourselves by touching ourselves. This kind of dialectic relationship is something I will refer to later a bit, but we should keep it in our mind. Besides of this contact to oneself, touch is a very important aspect concerning our sensorical and cognitive perception of the world. This is primarily true if we regard the ontogenetic development of knowledge. Touch enables, for example, children to discover the shape, the texture, the materiality, the quality of objects. To get a feeling what it means if you speak about a hard or soft object, about a wet or dry object, all these raw, polished, warm and curious, all these qualitative information about material attributes are only comprehensive because we have this sense of touch. But the meaning of attributes like rough or soft cannot be reduced to a detailed, explicit description which we get by some other person. For example, imagine yourself and you try to explain what it means if you're speaking about the wet aspect. It's absolutely not enough. It's not possible. And we have this as a new work with artificial intelligence. We try to get a kind of knowledge about qualitative attributes into a computer program, and it was absolutely possible really to explain what it means if you speak. to get real meaning of what is meant by this qualitative information. So touch is a kind of very important fundament of our approach to the world and a very important fundament of our cognitive capabilities. Following this, you may say that touch is a kind of very important experience, a continuous field of exploration of fundamental we must be able to refer to our sensory experience. We must have met objects which the software are attaching them. We must have had developed this kind of contact with the objects which enable us to understand what we mean by this qualitative information. Furthermore, there are a lot of phenomenologists which point out that not only touch as a kind of one of our senses is a very important aspect in our approach to the world, but furthermore, that also perception and our acoustical perception, our visual perception, our acoustical perception, is very much influenced by this notion of touch. For example, we have in Germany the notion of abtasten, that we, I would translate it rather freely as palpating viewing. What means that if you are looking at a picture, really, you understand what I mean? Translation, if you are integrated in a specific language. With our eyes, we are touching the pictures and visual impressions, and again, ordinary language gives a hint or indicates what we mean by that. Because very often, by describing a view or glance, we are using attributes which are coming from the sense of touch. We speak about a warm glance of fire. So there are notions which are influenced by this idea of touch, and the same is also in the field of acoustical perception, where we speak about a warm sound, a soft sound, something like that. So we may sum up, touch is a very important, very fundamental approach to the world, and a lot of our cognitive approaches, our cognitive acts, are totally influenced by this idea of touching something, getting in touch. Okay, another aspect I wanted to refer to is, as I said before, the idea of touch as a method of verification. I had a very nice folio, but as it was the only one, I didn't want to make the whole invention here, where was the, I can't describe it, it's too difficult to understand. In reference to the intertwinedness to touch and the other senses and cognition, I would like to refer to a quotation of Voltaire. He speaks about, or he spoke about, Lénard de l'expérience. That means that according to his opinion, the palpable, that what we can touch, experience by the sense of touch, is a source of valid knowledge. This refers to this idea of touch as a means of verification, which we already met in everyday language when we look at expressions like toucher la vérité du droit. In respect to this, I would like to refer to an old story which played an important role in Christian religion. After Jesus died, he reappeared to his disciples at Easter. Thomas, one of his men, did not believe in his real existence. So he asked Jesus if it was possible to touch him, to become sure whether Jesus is something or somebody who is a real person, or something which is more a phantom or a ghost. So Jesus allowed Thomas to touch him, and after that, Thomas believed in his existence. And it was very interesting that Jesus afterwards said that it's necessary to believe without having that, without always being confronted with the idea of touch. So that he warned everybody of the people who are involved in Christian religion, that they believe in God without being forced to touch him. And Dino Hofer's family made the following remark in a letter about his life. He said, si vous voulez que je croie en Dieu, il faut que vous me le fassiez toucher. What means that only the people who are really doubting the existence of somebody always wanted to touch the thing which they should believe in. But in Christian religion, there was a strong force that people should believe in something without touching it. And I think it's a very interesting story, because the whole philosophy was always influenced by it. Because touch, you can see it really in this way, did play a very, very small role, a very important role in the whole idea of epistemology, of getting in contact with the world and something like that. Because you really had to believe in what we see or what we hear, and touch was really blended out in our approach to the world. And I think there are a lot of reasons for that, and I think I've already mentioned some of them, but I cannot refer to everything here as dissemination. If you look from this point of view, looking at touch as a kind of verification method, at children again, I think it's a very important field of exploration, then we see, can see very often that children touch something if they want to become clear if something is real or artificial. And I for myself, if I observe myself, very often when I'm in a restaurant, there are clothes on the table, first thing I do is touch them to see if they are real or artificial. So, I don't know, for example, in our GMB center, we get always artificial flowers, but some natural, but we touch them only to get a feeling of how they are. So, we find a lot of fears where this idea of touch and method of verification plays an important role. For example, medical diagnosis, which I observed a long time in a research project, we have a lot of diagnostic methods. We have this anamnesis, where people are asked about their symptoms, and we have all these technical facilities which enables us, or us, to get a kind of idea of what a kind of illness the patient might have. But then, palpation, touching the patient, plays still a very important role. It is sometimes described by people who describe their diagnostic method as a kind of verification method. So even if you have had a temperature of 40 degrees, people touch the patient to see if it is right. Or you look at the pulse, or you make a kind of palpation where you are trying to get a kind of feeling what the patient might have. So touch also here in scientific field is a kind of verification method, which is also very important. So we may say that touch is an important method to find evidence for beliefs and estimations. We cannot touch, what we cannot touch might be not real, could be a product of our fantasies and imaginations. And it's very interesting if we regard, for example, virtual environments, and we encounter the so-called virtual environments as months and weeks, where I used to make some research, that is a kind of virtual environment where people can have contact with each other by exchanging texts, by having a kind of positive contact, by speaking to each other by using the phone or micro, and also by seeing each other sometimes, for example, in programs like you see with a video camera on your computer, and then you have a kind of picture of the other one to whom you're talking, speaking. People have a strong desire to get in real touch with the other one to verify their ideas, their estimations, their estimations about the other person. And very often this context has been described as shock, which appeared when people met each other because there was this big gap between the imagination on the one hand and the real person on the other hand. So here again, touching in the sense of having the real contact with the other person plays a very important role in verifying estimation of beliefs and imaginations. So the first point, the fourth point I want to refer to is the idea of touch and emotion. I think I have not to tell a lot about that because everybody knows the strong relationship between touch and emotion. If we, for example, refer to the idea of erotic relationships or something like that. In his wonderful book, but not long school on the back, he refers to the notion of touch in the following way. According to him, touch is the domain of silent and subtle signs, not only the celebration of the senses, but even more of sex. In erotic situations, which he described in this book, this kind of dialogue by using subtle and silent signs of touch plays a very important role, perhaps the most important role, the way how people touch each other, how people have a kind of contact by approaching their bodies to each other, how they touch casually or intentionally, gestures which seem to be without any arms, but which carry the whole sense of the arm already in them. This all creates an atmosphere in people, an atmosphere of resonance and responsibility, of For example, if you don't like a person, you really try to avoid the past. You really try to avoid to get in touch with them. If you are interested in a person, then Papa Dalton, we get contact with the past. We try to touch it. So there is a kind of, as the German philosopher Herder said it, a kind of different spatial direction. On the one hand, we have a kind of attraction. On the other hand, we have a kind of repulsion. We feel attracted by something or somebody, or we try to get away from this person, to get out of touch. This complex interrelation of attraction and repulsion, of looking for proximity and distance, of searching and avoiding direct contact and touch, makes everybody fragile, hurtable, anxious, in effect, and on the other hand, eager, greedy, and full of desire. So it's a very complex thing which takes place in touch, and so I think because of this complexity, we can see this strong relationship between touch and emotions. And what is also very interesting is that in touching the common number, we come up to only closeness, but as well the strangeness of the other. We in the same moment feel the foreign aspects of the common number, we become aware of the strangeness of the other one, but also we become aware of the strangeness of ourselves. That means that we become aware of the fact that our body is the kind of part where we can never gain total control of it. And the strangeness of ourselves, in being aware of the strangeness of the other body, is probably the fact why we are sometimes so anxious, we would say, to get in touch, to get in close touch with some other person. But I would like to refer to that again when I speak about touch as contact. Some remarks about touch as a magical sphere. I think this strong relationship between emotions and touch, which I just tried to outline briefly here, explains a bit about touch as a magical sphere. If you, for example, look at magic cultures or magic rituals in other cultures and things like shamanism, touching was always a very important way to create a magical atmosphere, a contact between persons and persons and objects, which could have a kind of mystical effect beyond a concrete exploratory function. For example, in religion, blessing and benediction is often directly connected with touching the other. For example, shamans cure people only by touching their bodies. And there are a lot of different cultures in which magic of touch plays an important role because people believe that a specific energy flows from one person object to the other. Massages, anointments, unctions, for example, have always been regarded as a very important method to destroy the evil, for example. Magical and mystical ideas concerning the dynamic power of touch have been described by several technologists who described or observed different cultures. And for example, some of them have developed the idea of urenda, that is kind of notionally describes a magical fluid which is transferred from one to the other by touch. Also in Christian culture, touch has played an enormous role if you regard, for example, the miracles, because something was only changed or a miracle only took place if somebody has touched it. For example, Jesus had to touch bread and wine, but Jesus had to touch somebody only to really influence the fact that the bread and wine changed. So we really have to ask ourselves, why does touch in all these mystical and magical rituals play such an important role? What does take place there? And so we came to this idea of touch as a continuous contact and dialogue with the world. Now I come to the point of the for me, it was very interesting to touch on these different perspectives, rather feeling for the whole semantic state and the relevance of touch in our approach to the world generally. So we can say, if we sum up until now, purely unconditional. A dialectic reciprocal relation, a dissolution of the dichotomy between activity and passivity, subject and object. And that is something I want to refer to in this chapter when I speak about touch and contact. To explain in more detail what I mean by that, I would like to refer to this terminologist perspective, which has been created by the which has been worked out by other philosophers like the Tor, etc. Here, people were very interested in the way how we are embedded in the world by our body. And this embodiment, embeddedness with our body in the world, shows a kind of specific reciprocity which is officially becoming apparent in the idea of touch. The reciprocal relationship between the touching person and the touched is rooted in what Merleau-Ponty calls the double existence of the body. So, as Merleau-Ponty sees it, the body can neither be interpreted as pure consciousness nor as a pure object, physical object in the world. Accordingly, the body has a kind of double existence. What means it is simultaneously an external being, a kind of physical object in the world, we are part of body. But on the other hand, it is a kind of experience. So we always see if we are physical body in the world, we are feeling our body, we have a kind of conscious relationship to the body, or I would say we are consciousness being a body. So there is a kind of ambiguity between a material object and a pure consciousness, which allows equally a view from the outside, we can regard our body as a kind of object, or from the inside, the experience we live in our body at the same time. Merleau-Ponty speaks in this context about two different concepts. He speaks about a corpus, that is a subjectively experienced touching body, and on the other hand, the corps physical, that is the empirical touch body. But however, he says, there are structures of one entity, the human system. I would like to give an example of it. For example, if I see my hand, and if I, with this hand, I touch my other hand, you see the ambiguity already. With this hand, that is the experience, subjectively experienced part of my body. I touch the body, which in this moment becomes a kind of object. It's a physical instance. But on the same, well, in the same moment, this hand is also something which is experienced by me, because I feel how I'm touched. So, and on the other hand, this hand feels how the other hand is touching it. So there's a kind of ambiguity, ambiguous relationship between touched and touching and being touched. And this is something which is really very interesting concerning our contact to the world. Perhaps we can discuss about it. I'm not so sure if that is totally clear, and I'm speaking about that too long. But as you are very in the dark, I have not this kind of interaction with you. It's really interesting. I really feel like being on a stage. And now I understand what people say, there's a kind of dark audience that doesn't know what it is. Okay. So the body and the mind, the intelligible and the empirical, are thus bound together via the body. But being a body not only means a constant mediation between inside and outside, as I just put it, but beyond that, as a physical body, one is always part of the world to which one refers in touching, acting, and reflecting. In touching something or someone, the physical object therefore doesn't only depend on subjective self-determination and on subjective intentions, but is also governed by the laws of the world, that is to say, by the own dynamics and the own sense of the phenomena which are touched by us. We are always in touch with the world beyond its concrete act of touching us, because we live as a physical being in a continuous fusion with the material and social world, which of course does not need to be inclined towards us, but which restructures the forms of our action challenging, resisting, and initiating them. I think this shows very clearly that that's why the idea of touch and the idea of body embeddedness in the world, the dichotomy between the subject and the world, between the touching and the touched, is overcome or surmounted. Because there exists this continuous contact with the world. So you may say that the body is subject and the way of this touching and touched are interrelated with each other or intertwined with each other. Map out a hardware sphere, as you know, which implies a kind of cooperation between the world and the subject, which guarantees a constant pact, which also implies a kind of overcoming the division into a recognizing subject on the one hand and the world which has been recognized by it. The unity of the touching and the touched, which becomes obvious in this physical being in the world, realized by our body, shows that in the experience of touch, there is no distance between the subject and the world which has been developed in the epistemological tradition. So, if we take all this into account, and if we think about the close relationship between touching and the touched, then we see that the dissolution of the cognitive philosophical duality of action and intention will be surmounted here by this constant contact with the world. According to this old tradition, one could always distinguish between an active subject or an active instance, which does something or touches something, and a passive object number to whom something is happening or which is touched. This dichotomy is called into question if we take into account that the body always shows this general mixture of activity and passion, which we just became clear by looking at this example of the hands. So the physical subject is always simultaneously giving and receiving meaning. We touch, and we are touched by the object, because our touching is already a reaction of our body to the questioning atmosphere which is given out by the touched object number. We act whereby our body is answering the opportunity dumbly presented by the environment or the people around. And in the same situation, in the same way, the object number is always acting and reacting within one. So a communication takes place between the aspect, between the phenomenon which we want to touch and ourselves. It is a kind of acting and reacting, an intertwining of these two aspects which we have to take account if we regard. I have an illustration of it because it's rather abstract, as I said before. For example, if you are looking at a sculptress which is working with a stone, she has some ideas concerning the idea of how she wants to build up this stone, how the sculpture should look like. That are her artistic ideas. Sure is she's approaching to the stone and she's touching it. And in the way she's touching it, she will change her concentration. That is to say that the material, the stone, has a kind of own dynamic, own sense, to which the sculptress is answering. So it is kind of dialogue which develops in that situation. I spoke with some artists a long time, I mean, we had long discussions about them, and even a painter or even a musician told me that it is really kind of dialogue which takes place between the own intentions and the material which shows some own dynamic to which the artist has to answer. So artistic intentions always breaks down on what the material prescribes, allows, and prevents. And this is not only true for the physical material, but also for the social, culturally shaped material, like sounds and tones and musical harmony and something like that. For example, when I wrote a very long time, these people which were mentioned from you yesterday, welcome. So they told me that these cultural actual shape material of sounds and harmonies or something like that is a kind of resistance which always meets the intention of the artist. So we really have to describe artistic creation more than a kind of dialogue, than the idea of putting an idea into a work by really realizing the intention. So artistic activity therefore much more causes of resonance, of dialogue, than the conscious transformation of an idea into an object. This reciprocal relationship between the subject and the world is especially true for touch. By touching, the relation between the asking and the responding person or object is rather close. Activity and passivity are intertwined in this process because the touched person is reacting immediately by touching the other one, not in the way how the body behaves. For example, if I'm touching the skin of somebody whom I love first, then the way this skin is reacting influences already the way how I touch it. So there's a content interaction between the touch and the touching. So this separation, which was typical of the tradition of personality, activity, passivity, is really surmounted by the idea of touch. So, however, if one accepts this premise that touching is never the sole product of a controlling mental subject, but rather touch can only continually be understood at the stage of its emergence, and which indirectly and laterally unfolds in the specific reversibility through which the alternating encroachment of nature, sociality, and spirit expresses itself. Coming to the last part, touch as a silent and gentle dialogue of the world. So, I think if you take all these encounters until now, you may say that touch means having a silent contact with the world, the objects, other people. Silent contact means that there is a predisposed contact with the sins or with other people before they have become spoken or eventual contact with the issues that all have some living issues. This idea of a silent speech refers to the fact that we are embedded in this continuous communication with the world, which becomes apparent in the fact that we are always in touch with the world by touching and being touched. For example, when I'm sitting here in the chair, I'm touched by the world, even if I'm not totally aware of it. I'm touching by myself and I'm touched by the chair. And this continuous communication which I have with the world by being in touch with it creates an atmosphere which influences our approach to the world in general, which influences our cognitive acts to a large extent. This notion of touch as a continuous contact with the world is not only relevant in respect to our relationship to the so-called natural world around us, which doesn't exist as we all know, but furthermore, it is important regarding our contact to others. Here we can distinguish between touch in a concrete sense, that is a direct touch, shaking hands, embracing, erotic, sexual contact, and furthermore, but then one touch in a more metaphorical sense, that is contact through our bodies, gestures, glances, etc., which gives us a feeling of being in touch, of keeping touch, of losing touch with us. And here I want to make an example which I really would like to put for discussion, because I'm not an expert in this field, the idea of improvisation, because I think it's a very good example. In former times, I was very often in concerts where people were improvising jazz concerts. And I was always very amazed by this idea of improvisation, because there is a kind of contact which develops between people and between instruments. A contact which is not made explicitly, but which exists by glances, position of the body, the way horns are initiated, the way people are making kind of movements. There's a kind of continuous, very vivid dialogue, which is a kind of atmosphere in which this kind of improvisation, which kind of music arises, which makes it possible. And that is described as a kind of touch in this metaphorical sense, that means to have the contact with the other one besides any explicit play. bare sand dialogue arise. Between the touch and hand and the touch object of person, there is, and I would say that means, there is never a total coincidence. In contrast, there is a kind of pairs, dichotomy, which is responsible for foregoing affordances, which is responsible for the force-going dialogue, for the resonance and responsivity which develops in this dialogue by touching, in this important sense, and which stimulates further dialogues and conflicts. So to sum up, the intertwinedness, or Christine would say, the chiasmus between the touching and the touch points to a different approach to the world, which is no longer characterized by domination and control of the intentional active subject, but which opens a new phase of coexistence, according to which subject and object build up a reciprocal relationship, well aware of the fact that the touching act is always a reaction to what is already initiated by the touch object. So we may conclude that touching is an act of responsivity, of resonant behavior, because we are always answering to the atmosphere and the affordances which are already given by the objects and the persons around us, the objects and persons we want to get in touch with. In this way, touch is an open dialogue with the world, which can never fully be made explicit nor be captured by reflection. Therefore, touch unfolds a different approach to the world, an approach which depends on this norm of resonance by the dialectic of activity and passivity. This implies to be open and sensitive towards the forces of the environment and to be acting and reacting instantly in the same way, to accept the strangeness and unavailability of the other and of myself, being aware of the fact that autonomy and heteronomy are always existing in parallel to each other. This approach to the world can be compared with a kind of tender, gentle, and soft relation to the other, which is which takes place or which substitutes the old idea of domination and control, which has been characteristic or typical for our old epistemological approach to the world. So it was the pastoral game, but I want to thank you. Work
Imagine that if sensoric relationship that suddenly was there with the electronic sounds, that you get a different kind of you know, curves and different kind of expression, as you say. And I think that the notion of physical effort is something that everybody can understand. You know, somebody, by misunderstanding, I was once programmed in the Middle East American Jerusalem, next to a kind of rivalry, kind of, you know, like a country in Western party. And so, you know, they were over slow for people. And you could notice that the fact that they saw me sweat and work with their hands, you know, like, that they related to that. You know, they were like, okay, yeah, we get it, you know. and that's a universal language, that our effort, that whether the person, you know, like, it went to extreme, but
it's way on the way with the Greek language.
Yes,
yeah, who's the strongest?
Yeah. I think it's Greek language, it's Greek is sort of the picture. But I would like to refer to my final last concern, your idea of political resistance, which you mean when you're playing, for example, violin and things like that. To work with this resistance and to get to develop the dialogue with the instrument by teaming up this resistance of the instrument, it's something which was, I think, truly important to the work of Lachenmann. I was able to attend a symposium where he described how he is composing his work. And he's really working together with the instrumentalists to get aware of the resistance which they met when they are playing, for example, in violin or in cello. And he was really playing with this resistance and take this as a kind of source of the chance which he used in his improvisation and in his composition. And I think that was amazingly interesting for me, because he was really well aware of this idea of reality, of reciprocity, this idea of having a kind of contact with the violin or with the instrument, being aware of its own sense, its own dynamic, which you always need when you try to compose something. I think this is really interesting. I think it's very interesting.
How are we to resolve the fact that you do want to conceptualize it, you do want to understand it, you do want to understand it as something untouchable, like concepts of harmonies. I mean, there is this design, I know lots of, there is a bunch of also existing positions who are also very interested in harmony and communication. So something which is almost abstract, except perhaps untouchable.
I mean, the question I'm thinking about is, well, who worked all this effort with this? You know, I mean, here we are axiomatic, right, at this conference. We're all going to say, well, we want to have effort, we want to have touch. I guess I'm more interested in what you said earlier about, well, you've got this whole philosophical tradition, which comes, I guess, you were located in Christianity, or maybe some people were located in Plato. I'm not really sure. But, I mean, is there contemporary articulation of why does it continue to come up?
Yeah.
And who benefits by it? You know, what's the usefulness of it?
I can give some examples about my social awareness where I did my last research in Colorado. When I ask people why are they so interested in having contact with people with whom they would never get a real touch because they're living millions of, not millions, but thousands of kilometers far away, they say, I can develop a kind of intensive contact. I can be very free in telling some very personal things. I can develop a very intensive contact, even if I'm not in touch with the person, because it makes me not anxious. So I was asking, but why are you anxious if you're really getting in touch together? And it was the strangeness which they were confronted with, the unavailability of the other. What means that if you are confronted with a real person, then you feel its strangeness, its unavailability, and you can never get total control of it. But if it is a product of your own imagination, then you have kind of control, because you can form and shape it along to your fantasies. But that's one point, and the other point is that I think it's very interesting. Somebody said, oh, I'm very glad that I have this very intensive relationship with somebody who is far away, and they had kind of really a lot of relationship. They were telling things which were really interesting. Not very strange. So I asked him, I'm very interested, why you don't want to get in real touch with this person, you have all these fantasies and desires. He said, oh, I cannot become AIDS. You know, in good, there was a danger of being infected by me. And I said, that's very interesting, because this kind of anxiety, which really
implies that if you are really confined together, the head is this close.
You're doing it in general there.
Yes, also
there's a finish about control and
yes, exactly.
Power there.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Around the risk of losing control.
Yes, that's exactly what I want to say. That's
it is about availability.
And your control, I think it's very important that if you are confined with estrangement and unavailability of the other person, then you are losing this.
Well, this is no, which is kind of different, right? I just said that the absence of touch contributes to the possibility of control.
Yeah.
I seem to say. I mean, the fact that you can't, back to that first example, the fact that you can't touch the person means that you feel in control of the environment, but if you have to face dialogue and resistance, then you're losing that.
Yes, exactly. That's exactly the thing. And I think that it's also this idea of activity and passivity. This dichotomy which characterizes the old epistemological tradition, that you really need to intronize a subject which has lost its contact with the world, that it really could control and dominate the world, which otherwise would show its strangeness and unavailability, and so the subject would lose its dominant position. I think that was good, and you can really see that the epistemological tradition is really interesting. But he wants to say something.
The three-dimensionality of it, of sound, of presence, your presence, touching it, it strikes me also the two-dimensionality of the recording you let us hear yesterday. I missed the physicality, the musician. I don't know, are we developing a new kind of touching, a two-dimensional touch?
Mm-hmm.
This relationship we were talking about.
I think that was the question which you sent yesterday. It was a discussion which you could not go on. No, we can stop there.
Can you move me up the house lights just a little bit, please? Because I think it's
quite difficult
for
Barbara
to.
Yeah.
No, I see now. I think I have a problem with really that I have an idea.
I think this is
yeah, I could see it.
This is also the one I was trying to put to George, asking about the virtual drawing. For example, to what extent do we need to refresh these new gestural modes that we are developing by referring to the materiality of the world? And for the moment, George's ideas about what or whoever it was are getting in enough with physical instruments to have this reference point. But I'm thinking in terms of what happens a few decades from now, when you have people who have taken as their models the drummers from the thinking with the physical instruments, and we are simply replicating this gesture. And I think that maybe we are moving towards other forms of gesture and virtuosity. At the moment, perhaps they're impoverished because we don't know where they're anchored, they're in quicksand. But when you see kids in arcades playing machines and developing incredible forms of virtuosity, I think maybe this type of this new form of touch, or what you're talking about, this new form of screen-based communication, is something that we should be taking quite seriously in terms of how much margin we explore on gestural virtuosity of the new forms of contact. I think it's a really important question.
But isn't it
kind of complication?
Yeah.
Isn't it due to the fact that the technology, as being developed for the purposes and other purposes, is pushing us a little bit in that direction? I mean, we're using those computers because they're available, and we're not able to develop our own machines that easily yet. Now that you see that more of us and more of the institutions have the possibilities to develop instruments, you see a total different development. Another answer to George's last question is the fact that the technology of electronics allows you to have a separated controller from the sound producing device, a clarinet. You really have to fill those holes with your fingers, otherwise it wouldn't play. So with an electronic instrument, I could play it here and it could sound next to your chair. And I think this is just temporary problems because we haven't been able to mold the technology to our goals. And I think that's really what should happen, is that the artist can decide about how this technology is being developed. I think the whole two-dimensional area is something that is forced upon us, and that it wouldn't be my first choice to work with anymore. And I can imagine that you can use that restriction as the friction you need to be artistic. You can consciously choose.
choose to use something stupid to try to make something with as an artistic fight. But it wouldn't be, you know, the desire. But the other hand is with the non-connected controller, which I mean not connected with the sound but body, you could make an instrument that has no resistance at all. So it would be an ergonomical design that makes you flip the finger the way you want, and it's not musical. So you have to consciously create these obstacles, these torture instruments, and some of us are trying.
Word by the way, the discussion of scripting earlier. Teachers were all here rather prejudiced towards people who are very physical and extrovert. Are we saying that novelists and mathematicians are just like the wall and want to turn up? They're not physical, they don't touch it. I'm personally fascinated by mathematics, as well as being a performer. And I'm worried about this, all this thing about physical literature. What about mental literature? What about working with aspects of sound that you can't change physically? Can only change through a computer program, which is something I like to do, which is a great deal of mental effort. It may take days to make a sound possible in training. Is there something wrong with that?
And nobody said
wonderful, wonderful. You have a wonderful work which has been done by a pupil of Lakoff, who is a cognitive psychologist at the university. The travel, yes, who has made good paper together, a very interesting work by looking for mathematical concepts and the source of their meaning. For example, looking that a lot of mathematical concepts, which seem to be rather abstract, are rooted in our corporate embedded in the world. Otherwise, mathematicians could not understand them. That is very easy to understand. If you look at the notion of space, if you look at the notion of numbers, scales, time, and something like this, it's essential in mathematics. So we may say, even if we look at very abstract concept, like mathematical concept, we always have to be aware of the fact that the significance of these concepts is rooted in our values, in our corporate values. That's the one point. The other point is that even if you take this into account, it is that we can have a kind of distance to the world by reflection, and that is absolutely true. But to look at this only from a kind of mentalistic perspective, by being not aware of these corporate values and world, which kind of significance for all these abstract concepts, that is the problem which we have. Not that there exists abstract perception. It exists, we all know it, and we all need it. I'm also fascinated sometimes by mathematics, and I think it is a very interesting approach. But on the other hand, if we only look from mathematics from this mentalistic point of view, then we are really losing contact to the kind of root of mass in this corporate event. So we have those, and that is exactly what I want to say.
I was trying to what sort of thing
I don't completely agree with the thing that's most interesting about my mind, because it's not true. It's very easy to think about number or space in a billion sense, but it's thinking about the space of an infinite number of dimensions to which you can therefore conceptualize ideas of time or mathematical functions, which are entirely abstract. They don't have any corporeal. And I find those things absolutely fascinating.
visual, imaginable things, and really abstract symbols.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, no, this is a necessary dialogue.
It's not just something going on in books.
Yeah.
It's dialogue between different kinds of people.
Exactly.
People of different relations.
Yes, absolutely. I would absolutely agree that there are different kinds of people. I think, and you are totally right, if you choose this way for yourself. But at least you are a body, aren't you? I think.
And well, you know, I could argue that I want to say one thing.
Very rarely continuous, so almost everything very discrete. In fact, I find in talking and teaching about new music to students and so on, I can't get around this idea and say, oh, we'll trigger something. It seems like music has gotten, and the notion that we have interactivity is one of starting and stopping as opposed to shaping. And so that's just a remarkable one to make about the lack of controllers. And now the problem with this thing about resistance, I just want to say, is I certainly agree with you, and I've often thought about all these different spatially controlled instruments, like the theremin, like the various radio drums, and the fact that there isn't something to, as a tactile feedback kind of thing. I think that there's some different problems with those things. But on the other hand, watching Aaron's
Natasha.
Clara Rockmore films her play, and seeing how in their own bodies they use a technique that's quite different than you would imagine, doing excellent. They're using their, she's playing in this manner, changing the capacitance by sort of massaging their own body. I mean, she's playing with her own hand shape and giving it to the other. Okay, one other issue that I'd like to ask, and maybe this is a really unrealistic feminist theory, but I can imagine my masculine talking about hammers and tools. I was so struck by the lack of the word tool. I wrote it down. I said, no tools yet.
Concerning the feminist approach, I want to say, I can show you perhaps some of the
reality rules, but seeing how far you can twist them. So how you interpret them, it's kind of a perverse way of, you don't follow the way you're going to follow a rule to be correct as in the legal fact. You're going to twist it around and see how close you can get to almost breaking it, that it becomes creative. And I think that's where sometimes if you put these rules down, if you actually stick by them, then you avoid some kind of creativity. And it's how you can figure out. That's why I think scam artists and people like that and show fun people and all that are so interesting, because they push the rules just to their limit. And that's where the creative edge starts to kick in. So
Yeah, so you've got gravity. Yeah, that's the big one. Since actually you're the next speaker, so I'd like to throw a couple of questions that you have on the course and secondary issue, or
I wanted to react to the machination issue.
To the body as Trevor Wishbone.
Exactly, yeah. I was thinking about the process. A process, when you go to a concert, you are assisting to a process, not just the music. When I'm at home and I put a CD, I just hear the result. When I see a video tape also, I just see the result. When I see the bodies in the space, I'm acting and resisting to anything, to their own struggle. There is a process. There I'm assisting to something. It's a direct communication. It's another level. That's all I want to say. It's just like making love. You don't just want to ejaculate, you want to go through the process. There is the old nature of it. Okay, but I mean, I put it with the ejaculation.
Let's go back to a question that Joel asked, but there's no response to the other. By the way, thank you for this extraordinary tour of the world platform. Joel asked about a language of touch, and this brings me to what has served me well over the last 15 years since the split brain work. That is, understanding the interaction between vision and language. And what I wanted to ask is, where does touch come in its relations to the other senses? In vision and language, just to be precise, to my mind, you don't understand anything unless you have both vision and word for it. And the typical questions that people ask when struggling with this and trying to get to that point is, I don't see it when you're describing something, right? Or they see the object, but what is it? They want words. But it's work from definition to object to example, from definition to example, from description to example. What happens with touch? Oh, I listened carefully in your talk to see when you would come close to this, and I thought the closest point is when you talk about gesture. Because gesture is the touch that doesn't touch. You have to see yes, manifests, which invites, but it's primarily visual. I mean, it's emotion which creates its effect by vision or by sound.
Approach to this notion of touch from different perspectives. You can approach to this notion of touch by looking at the concrete sensational experience which you have when you're touching objects, and where you get all this qualitative information about the object without the significance of a lot of attributes are not comparable. I gave some examples for that. I think you agree with that. That's the human. Furthermore, we have these gestures, which I would say are more in some on metaphorical touch, because with our body, we want to get in touch with somebody or with an object, but we are not really in kind of close contact, but we are only approaching by gestures, by our movements with the body. And so, you may say, that's a kind of metaphorical touch, which plays an enormous role, for example, in improvisation, where we are not really touching the musicians which we are playing, but where we are using our gestures, our body movements, our glasses, or something like that. To look for a kind of language of touch, I think, as I refer to Roland Barthes in his Fragment du discours en amoureux, where his piece about this language of subtle signs, which he thinks is touch, so that when we are in touch with somebody or when we are moving in a specific way, in a proper sense of touch, then we have a kind of language which is predisposed, but which is understandable for the other one if we are living in the same culture. So normally, you know also that in every culture, even in Western European cultures, there's a very different idea of touch. For example, we had a very nice workshop where there were English people and French people, and French people always embrace each other, and the English people blew up. Should you embrace one of the English and bring the child in the car? I said, what's my message? I don't want to be nice. So we always say, when we meet each other, say, hello. So we see that depending on the culture, there are very different notions what it means to be touched. So the cultures where touch is a totally natural way of getting in contact with each other, where otherwise touch is something which is accompanied by feelings of anxiety or something like that. So even if there is not a kind of language of touch in the sense that we really could verbalize it, I think there is a kind of implicit or predisposed language of touch, which we understand if we are living in the same culture. I would say that way. And so we spoke on this workshop also about the meaning of gestures, and afterwards the computer scientist asked me, is there a language of gestures? I said, yes, if you are observing people, you may say that there are gestures which are so intersubjectively comprehensive for everybody who's living in the same culture, that we might say, okay, we can explain and describe it, and we can say that is a kind of gesture language.
At the beginning of your talk, you said something nasty about abstract, but you made a very beautiful gesture to describe
it. So I think you can see it that way.
Very
interesting because it refers to the thing